John Murray Press Audio presents A Time of Gifts, on foot from Constantinople, from the Hook of Holland to the Middle Danube, by Patrick Leigh Fermor. Read for you by Crispin Redman. Linque tuas sedes, alianque litora quere, o Juvencius, Mario rerunt tibi nascito odo. Ne succumbe males. Te novaret ultimus hister, te tobaris gildios seraque regna canope, quique renascentum fibum canuntque cadentem, meo in externis fitci descintet herenas. Titus Petronius, Arbiter. I struck the board and cried, no more, I will abroad. What, shall I ever sigh and pine? My life and lines are free, free as the road, loose as the wind. George Herbert. For now the time of gifts is gone. O boys that grow, O snows that melt, O bathos that the years must fill, here is dull earth to build upon, undecorated. We have reached Twelfth Night or what you will. You will. Louis MacNeice. Introductory letter to Zan Fielding. Dear Zan, as I have only just finished piecing these travels together, the times dealt with are very fresh in my mind, and later events seem more recent still. So it is hard to believe that 1942 in Crete, when we first met, both of us black-turbaned, booted and sashed, and appropriately silver and ivory daggered, and cloaked in white goat's hair and deep in grime, was more than 3 decades ago. Many meetings and adventures followed that first encounter on the slopes of Mount Kedros, and fortunately, our kind of irregular warfare held long spells of inaction in the sheltering mountains. It was usually at eagle height, with branches or constellations overhead, or dripping winter stalactites, that we lay among the rocks and talked of our lives before the war. Indeed, indifference to the squalor of caves and speed at the approach of danger might have seemed the likeliest aptitudes for life in occupied Crete. But unexpectedly in a modern war, it was the obsolete choice of Greek at school which had really deposited us on the limestone. With an insight once thought rare, the army had realized that the ancient tongue, however imperfectly mastered, was a shortcut to the modern. Hence the sudden sprinkling of many strange figures among the mainland and island crags. Strange because Greek had long ceased to be compulsory at the schools where it was still taught. It was merely the eager choice, unconsciously prompted, I suspect, by having listened to Kingsley's Heroes in childhood, of a perverse and eccentric minority. Early hankerings which set a vague but agreeable stamp on all these improvised cave dwellers. As it chanced, neither of our school careers had run their course. Yours had been cut short by a family mishap, and mine by the sack, and we had both set off on our own at an earlier age than most of our contemporaries. These first wanderings, impecunious, moss-repellent, frowned on by our respective elders, and utterly congenial, had pursued rather similar lines. And as we reconstructed our pre-war lives for each other's entertainment, we soon agreed that the disasters which had set us on the move had not been disasters at all, but wild strokes of good luck. This audiobook is an attempt to complete and set in order, with as much detail as I can recapture, the earliest of those disjointedly recounted travels. The narrative, which should end at Constantinople, has turned out longer than I expected. I have split it in two, and this first volume breaks off in the middle of an important but arbitrary bridge spanning the Middle Danube. The rest will follow. From the start, I wanted to dedicate it to you, which I now do with delight and some of the formality of a bullfighter throwing his cap to a friend before a corrida. May I take advantage of the occasion by turning this letter into a kind of introduction? I want the narrative, when it begins, to jump in the deep end without too much explanatory delay. But it does need a brief outline of how these travels came about. We must go back a bit. In the second year of World War I, soon after I was born, my mother and sister sailed away to India, where my father was a servant of the Indian government, and I was left behind, so that one of us might survive if the ship were sunk by a submarine. I was to be taken out when the oceans were safer, and, failing this, remain in England until the war had reached its quick and victorious end. But the war was long, and ships scarce. 4 years passed, and during the interim, on a temporary footing which perforce grew longer, I remained in the care of a very kind and very simple family. This period of separation was the opposite of the ordeal Kipling describes in Bar Bar Black Sheep. I was allowed to do as I chose in everything. There was no question of disobeying orders. None were given. Still less was there ever a stern word or an admonitory smack. This new family, and a background of barns, ricks, and teasels, clouded with spinneys and the undulation of ridge and furrow, were the first things I can remember setting eyes on. And I spent these important years, which are said to be such formative ones, more or less as a small farmer's child run wild. They have left a memory of complete and unalloyed bliss. But when my mother and sister got back at last, I rushed several fields away and fought off their advances in gruff Northamptonshire tones, and they understood that they had a small savage on their hands and not a friendly one. The joy of reunion was tempered by harrowing dismay. But I was secretly attracted to these beautiful strangers nevertheless. They were extravagantly beyond anything in my range of conjecture. I was fascinated by the crocodile pattern of the shoes in which one of them ended, and by the sailor suit of the other, who was 4 years my senior. The pleated skirt, the three white stripes on the blue collar, the black silk scarf with its white lanyard and whistle, and the ribbanded cap with the still indecipherable gold letters that spelled out HMS Victory. Between the two, a black Pekingese with white feet resembling spats was floundering and leaping in the long grass and giving tongue like a lunatic. Those marvellously lawless years, it seemed, had unfitted me for the faintest shadow of constraint. With tact and charm and skill, backed by my swift treason and by London and Peter Pan and Where the Rainbow Ends and Choo Chin Chow, my mother succeeded in bringing about a complete shift of affection and in taming me, more or less, for family purposes. But my early educational ventures, when the time came, at kindergarten, then at a school of my sister's, which also took small boys, and finally at a horrible preparatory school near Maidenhead, named after a Celtic saint, ended in uniform catastrophe. Harmless in appearance, more presentable by now, and of a refreshingly unconstricted address, I would earn excellent opinions at first, but as soon as early influences began to tell, those short-lived virtues must have seemed a cruel Fauntleroy veneer, cynically assumed to mask the Charles Adams fiend that lurked beneath. It coloured with an even darker tint the sum of misdeeds which soon began heaping up. When I catch a glimpse of similar children today, I am transfixed with fellow feelings and with dread. First, bewilderment reigned, and then despair. After a particularly bad cropper when I was about 10, I was taken to see two psychiatrists. In a recent biography, I read with excitement that the first of these, and the most likable, had been consulted by Virginia Woolf, and I thought for a moment that I might have gazed at her across the waiting room. Alas, it was before I was born. The second, more severe in aspect, recommended a co-educational and very advanced school for difficult children near Bury St. Edmunds. Salsham Hall, at Salsham Lay Sallows, was an unclassifiable but engaging manor house with woods and a rough lake in a wide-skied and many-belfried expanse of Suffolk. It was run by a grey-haired, wild-eyed man called Major Truthful, and when I spotted two beards, then very rare, among the mixed and eccentric-looking staff, and the heavy bangles and the amber and the tassels and the homespun, and met my fellow alumni, about 30 boys and girls, from 4-year-olds to nearly 20, all in brown jerkins and sandals, the musical near-genius with occasional fits, the millionaire's nephew who chased motor cars along country lanes with a stick, the Admiral's pretty and slightly kleptomaniac daughter, the Persephone's son with nightmares and an infectious inherited passion for heraldry, the backward, the somnambulists, the mythomaniacs, by which I mean those with an inventive output more pronounced than the rest, which, as no one believed us, did no harm, and finally, the small bad hats, like me, who were merely very naughty. I knew I was going to like it. The nature-worshipping eurythmics in a barn and the country dances in which the major led both staff and children were a shade bewildering at first because everybody was naked. Nimbly and gravely, keeping time to a cottage piano and a recorder, we sped through the figures of gathering peace cods, Sellingers round, picking up sticks and old mole. It was midsummer. There were walled gardens close at hand, and giant red and gold gooseberries, and the nets over the loaded currant bushes foiled starlings, but not us, and beyond them the trees and the water descended in dim and beckoning perspectives. I understood the implications of the landscape at once. Life under the greenwood tree. To choose a maid Marian and a band, to get the girls to weave yards of Lincoln green on their therapeutic looms, and then to slice and sew them into rough hoods with crenellated collars, cut bows and string them, carry off raspberry canes for arrows, and to take to the woods was a matter of days. No one stopped us. Face a que vudras was the whole of their law. English schools, the moment they depart from the conventional track, are oases of strangeness and comedy, and it is tempting to linger, but vaguely guessed at improprieties amongst the staff or the older children, or both, things of which we knew little in our sylvan haunts, brought about the dissolution of the place, and I was soon back for a second chance, a forest exile among the snake belts and the bat oil of the horrible preparatory school. But predictably, after this heady freedom, not for long. My mother had to cope with these upheavals. I would turn up in mid-term, once at our cottage in Dodford, a tiny thatched village under a steep halt full of foxgloves, and indeed full of foxes, with a brook for its one street, where she was simultaneously writing plays and, though hard up, learning to fly a moth biplane at an aerodrome 40 miles away. Once at Primrose Hill Studios near Regent's Park, within earshot of the lions in the zoo at night, where she had persuaded Arthur Rackham, a neighbour in that cloister, to paint amazing scenes, navigable birds' nests in a gale wind, hobgoblin transactions under extruding roots and mice drinking out of acorns, all over an inside door, and more than once at 213 Piccadilly, which we moved to later, where a breakneck stair climbed to a marvellous Aladdin's cave of a flat, overlooking long chains of street lamps and the acrobatic sky signs of the circus. I would be hangdog on the doormat, flanked by a master with a depressing tale to unfold. Though upset, my mother was gifted with too much imagination and humour to let gloom settle for long. Nevertheless, these reverses filled me, for the time being, with suicidal despair. But this particular disaster happened to coincide with one of my father's rare leaves from directing the Geological Survey of India. He and my mother had parted by then, and since these furloughs only came round every 3 years, we scarcely knew each other. All at once, as though at the wave of a wand, I found myself high above Lake Maggiore, and then Como, trying to keep up with his giant stride across the gentian-covered mountains. He was an out-and-out naturalist, and rightly proud of being an FRS. Indeed, he had discovered an Indian mineral which was named after him, and a worm with 8 hairs on its back, and, brittle trove, a formation of snowflake. I wondered, much later on, when white specks whirled past in the Alps or the Andes or the Himalayas, whether any of them were his. That enormously tall and thin frame, dressed in a pepper-and-salt Norfolk jacket and knickerbockers, was festooned with accoutrements. Laden with his field glasses and his butterfly net, I would get my breath while he was tapping at the quartz, and the hornblender on the foothills of Monte Rosa with his hammer and clicking open a pocket lens to inspect the fossils and insects of Monte della Croce. His voice at such moments was simultaneously cavernous and enthusiastic. He would carefully embed wild flowers for later classification in a moss-lined vasculum, and sometimes halt for a sketch with his watercolours balanced on a rock. What a change, I thought, from those elephants and the jungles full of monkeys and tigers, which I imagined, not wholly wrongly, to be his usual means of transport and habitat. At ground level, I trailed behind him through half the picture galleries of northern Italy. 3 peaceful years followed. Gilbert and Phyllis Scott Malden, with 3 sons and half a dozen boys cramming for common entrance under their wing, lived in a large house with a rambling garden in Surrey. I can't think of them, nor of Mrs. Scott Malden's sister Josephine Wilkinson, who had a strong and separate influence later on, without the utmost gratitude and affection. He was an excellent classicist, and a kind and patient all-round teacher, and she filled out his firm structure with a great love of literature and poetry and painting. I was still an intermittent pest, but calmer existence began, and I shot ahead in the subjects I enjoyed, everything, that is, except mathematics, for which my ineptitude seemed akin to imbecility. We made up plays and acted Shakespeare scenes and lay about the grass under a holm oak with a dish of plums and listened to Mr. Scott Malden reading Gilbert Murray's translation of The Frogs, which would switch to the original to explain and give point to the comic passages and the onomatopoeia. We had built a hut in an enormous walnut tree with rope ladders climbing halfway, then hand over hand, and I was allowed to sleep in it all my last summer term. In spite of maths, I scraped through common entrance in the end and looked forward to public school life with ill-founded confidence. Copious reading about the Dark and the Middle Ages had floridly coloured my views of the past, and the King's School Canterbury touched off emotions which were sharply opposed to those of Somerset Maugham in the same surroundings. They were closer to Walter Pater's 70 years earlier, and probably identical, I like to think, with those of Christopher Marlowe earlier still. I couldn't get over the fact that the school had been founded at the very beginning of Anglo-Saxon Christianity, before the 6th century was out, that is. Fragments of Thor and Woden had hardly stopped smouldering in the Kentish woods. The oldest part of the buildings was modern by these standards, dating only from a few decades after the Normans had landed. There was a wonderfully cobwebbed feeling about this dizzy and intoxicating antiquity, an ambience both haughty and obscure which turned famous seats of learning, founded 800 or over 1,000 years later, into gaudy mushrooms, and seemed to invest these hoarier precincts, together with the wide green expanses beyond them, the huge elms, the dark entry and the ruined arches, and the cloisters, and while I was about it, the booming and jackdaw-crowded pinnacles of the great Angevin Cathedral itself, and the ghost of St. Thomas of Becket, and the Black Prince's bones, with an aura of nearly prehistoric myth. Although it was a one-sided love in the end, for a time things went well. I liked nearly everybody, from the headmaster and the housemaster down, and prospered erratically at dead and living languages, and at history and geography, at everything once more, except mathematics. I found my mind wandering at games, loved boxing and was good at it, and in summer, having chosen rowing instead of cricket, lay peacefully beside the Stour, well upstream of the rhythmic creaking and the exhortation, reading Lily Christine and Gibbon and gossiping with kindred lotus-eaters under the willow branches. Verse, imitative and bad, but published in school magazines nevertheless, poured out like ectoplasm. I wrote and read with intensity, sang, debated, drew and painted, scored minor successes at acting, stage managing and in painting and designing scenery, and made gifted and enterprising friends. One of these, a year older, was Alan Watts, a brilliant classical scholar who, most remarkably, wrote and published an authoritative book on Zen Buddhism years before the sect became fashionable, while he was still at school. Later, he became a respected authority on Eastern and Western religions. In his autobiography, In My Own Way, which came out shortly before his premature death a few years ago, he writes at some length of my troubles at school, and especially of their abrupt end, in the warm spirit of a champion. And if he didn't quite get the hang of it in one or two places, it was not his fault. What went wrong? I think I know now. A bookish attempt to coerce life into a closer resemblance to literature was abetted, it can only be, by a hangover from early anarchy. Translating ideas as fast as I could into deeds overrode every thought of punishment or danger. As I seem to have been unusually active and restless, the result was chaos. It mystified me and puzzled others. "You're mad!" Prefects and monitors would exclaim, brows knit in glaring scrum-half bewilderment, as new misdeeds came to light. Many of my transgressions involved breaking bounds as well as rules, climbing out at night and the like, only half of which were found out. Frequent gatings joined the mileage of Latin hexameters copied out as impositions, and lesser troubles filled in the gaps between more serious bust-ups. Absent-mindedness, forgetfulness and confusion about where I ought to be, and constant loss. Forgetting my books under the arches was a recurrent bane. There were some savage fights, also erratic behaviour which was construed, perhaps rightly, as showing off. Anything for a laugh was the usual term for this, and even when I succeeded, trying to be funny. Always that withering gerund. These strictures were often on monitors' lips, aediles and rod-bearing lictors. They were the guardians of an inflexible code, and all breaches were visited by swift and flexible sanctions which came whistling shoulder-high across panel studies and struck with considerable force. But, however spectacular the results, they left the psyche unbruised, and though they were disagreeable and, in this case, record-breaking in frequency, clinically and morally speaking, they didn't seem to take. If these meetings are carried off with enough studied nonchalance, a dark and baleful fame begins to surround the victim and makes him, in the end, an infliction past bearing. Everything was going badly, and my housemaster's penultimate report, in my third year, had an ominous ring. "Some attempts at improvement," it went, "but more to avoid detection. He is a dangerous mixture of sophistication and recklessness, which makes one anxious about his influence on other boys." Catastrophe was staved off for a few months. As I was thought to have done myself some damage skiing in the Berner Oberland just before I was 16, I skipped a term and a half, and on my return, I was temporarily excused games. When everyone trooped off with oblong balls under their arms, I could spin about Kent on a bicycle and look at the Norman churches at Patricksbourne and Bathstone and explore the remoter parts of Canterbury. This windfall of leisure and freedom soon coincided with a time when all good impressions were wiped out by a last series of misdeeds. A more prophetic eye would have seen that patience on high had at last given out, and that any further trouble would be hailed as a release long overdue. Intramural romances spring up and prosper in places of learning. But some exotic psychological fluke directed my glance beyond the walls and, once more, out of bounds. It was a time when one falls in love, hard and often, and my aesthetic notions, entirely formed by Andrew Lang's coloured fairy books, had settled years before on the long-necked, wide-eyed pre-Raphaelite girls in Henry Ford's illustrations, interchangeably king's daughters, ice maidens, goose girls and water sprites, and my latest wanderings had led me at the end of a green and sweet-smelling cave set dimly with flowers and multicoloured fruit and vegetation, a greengrocer's shop, that is, which she tended for her father, to the vision of just such a being. The effect was instantaneous. She was 24, a ravishing and sonnet-begetting beauty, and I can see her now, and still hear that melting and deep Kent accent. This sudden, incongruous worship may have been a bore, but she was too good-natured to show it, and perhaps she was puzzled by the verse which came showering in. I knew that such an association in the town, however innocent, broke a number of taboos too deep-rooted and well understood to need any explicit veto. Nevertheless, I headed for the shop beyond the cattle market the moment I could escape. But the black clothes we wore, those stiff wing collars and the wide and speckled straw boaters with their blue and white silk ribbons, were as conspicuous as broad arrows. My footsteps were discreetly dogged, my devices known, and after a week I was caught red-handed. Holding Nelly's hand, that is to say, which is about as far as this suit was ever pressed. We were sitting in the back shop on upturned apple baskets, and my school days were over. Captain Grimes was right. A few months after this setback, the idea of an army career, which had been floating mistily in the air for some time, began to take firmer shape, and the prospect of entering Sandhurst raised its distant hurdle. But what about the sack? When he was appealed to, my ex-housemaster, a strange and brilliant man, composed and dispatched the necessary letter of recommendation. And, like the captain's, it was a corking good letter, too. There were no bitter feelings. There had been disappointment on the side of the school authorities, as well as relief, utter dejection on mine. But I felt thankful they had alighted on more avowable grounds for my eclipse than the charge of being an intolerable nuisance. The actual pretext could be made to sound dashing and romantic. I had not yet sat for school cert, which, because of maths, I would certainly have failed, and as it was indispensable for would-be cadets, I soon found myself in London, 17 by now, cramming for an exempting examination called the London Certificate. I spent most of the next 2 years in Lancaster Gate, then in Ladbroke Grove with rooms of my own overlooking treetops, under the tolerant and friendly aegis of Denis Prideaux. I did maths, French, English, and geography with him, and Latin, Greek, English, and history, often in deck chairs in Kensington Gardens, with Lawrence Goodman. Unconventional and a poet, he took me to every Shakespeare play that appeared. During the first year, I led a fairly sensible life, had a number of friends, was asked away to stay in the country, followed rustic pursuits, and read more books than I have ever crammed into a similar stretch of time. I passed the London Cert, respectively in most papers, and even without disgrace in the subjects I dreaded. But a long interregnum still stretched ahead. One of the early chapters of this book touches at some retrospective length on the way things began to change. How I moved from the fairly predictable company of fellow army candidates into older circles, which were simultaneously more worldly, more bohemian, and more raffish. The remainder, more or less, of the bright young people, but 10 years and 20,000 double whiskies after their heyday, and looking extremely well on the regime. This new and captivating world seemed brilliant and rather wicked. I enjoyed being the youngest present, especially during the dissipated nocturnal ramblings in which every evening finished, "Oh, where's that rather noisy boy got to? We may as well take him too." I had reached a stage when one changes very fast. A single year contains 100 avatars, and while these were flashing kaleidoscopically by, the idea of my unsuitability for peacetime soldiering had begun to impinge. More serious still, the acceptance of 2 poems, and the publication of one of them, admittedly only on fox hunting, had fired me with the idea of authorship. In the late summer of 1933, with Mr. Prideaux's permission, I rashly moved into a room in an old and slightly leaning house in Shepherd Market, where several friends had already fixed their quarters. This little backwater of archways and small shops and Georgian and Victorian pubs had the charm, quite evaporated now, of a village marooned in the still intact splendours of Mayfair. I had a vision of myself as I moved in, settling down to writing with single-minded and almost Trollopian diligence. Instead, to my ultimate discomfiture but immediate delight, the house became the scene of wild and continuous parties. We paid almost nothing for our lodgings to Miss Beatrice Stewart, our kind-hearted landlady, and always late. She didn't mind this, but pleaded with us again and again in the small hours to make less noise. The friend and model of famous painters and sculptors in the past, she was accustomed to the more decorous bohemia of earlier generations. She had sat for Sargent and Sickert, and Shannon and Steer and Tonks and Augustus John, and her walls were radiant with mementos of those years. But the loss of a leg in a motor accident had cruelly slowed her up. Much later, a friend told me that she had been the model for Adrian Jones's bronze figure of Peace in the quadriga on Decimus Burton's Wellington Arch. Since then, I can never pass the top of Constitution Hill without thinking of her and gazing up at the winged and wreath-bearing goddess sailing across the sky. As the pigeon flies, it was under a minute from her windowsill. My scheme was not working well. That improvident flight from the rooms and meals and all that went with them at my tutor's had reduced my funds to £1 a week, and the way things were shaping, it looked as though opulence from writing might be delayed for a time. I managed somehow, but gloom and perplexities descended with the start of winter. Fitful streaks of promise and scrapes and upheavals had marked my progress so far. They still continued, but now I seemed to be floating towards disintegration in a tangle of submerged and ill-marked reefs. The outlook grew steadily darker and more overcast. About lamplighting time, at the end of a wet November day, I was peering morosely at the dog-eared pages on my writing table, and then through the panes at the streaming reflections of Shepherd Market, thinking, as night and day succeeded stormy weather on the gramophone in the room below, that lazy bones couldn't be far behind, when, almost with the abruptness of Herbert's lines at the beginning of these pages, inspiration came. A plan unfolded with the speed and the completeness of a Japanese paper flower in a tumbler. To change scenery. Abandon London and England and set out across Europe like a tramp, or, as I characteristically phrased it to myself, like a pilgrim, or a palmer, an errant scholar, a broken knight, or the hero of the cloister and the hearth. All of a sudden, this was not merely the obvious, but the only thing to do. I would travel on foot, sleep in hayricks in summer, shelter in barns when it was raining or snowing, and only consort with peasants and tramps. If I lived on bread and cheese and apples, jogging along on £50 a year like Lord Durham with a few noughts knocked off, there would even be some cash left over for paper and pencils and an occasional mug of beer. A new life! Freedom! Something to write about. Even before I looked at a map, two great rivers had already plotted the itinerary in my mind's eye. The Rhine uncoiled across it. The Alps rose up and then the wolf-harbouring Carpathian watersheds and the Cordilleras of the Balkans. And there, at the end of the windings of the Danube, the Black Sea was beginning to spread its mysterious and lopsided shape, and my chief destination was never in a moment's doubt. The levitating skyline of Constantinople pricked its sheaths of thin cylinders and its hemispheres out of the sea mist. Beyond it, Mount Athos hovered, and the Greek archipelago was already scattering a paper chase of islands across the Aegean. These certainties sprang from reading the books of Robert Byron. Dragon-green Byzantium loomed, serpent-haunted and gong-tormented. I had even met the author, for a moment, in a blurred and saxophone-haunted nightclub, as dark as Tartarus. I wondered during the first few days whether to enlist a companion, but I knew that the enterprise had to be solitary, and the break complete. I wanted to think, write, stay, or move on at my own speed and unencumbered, to gaze at things with a changed eye and listen to new tongues that were untainted by a single familiar word. With any luck, the humble circumstances of the journey would offer no scope for English or French. Flights of unknown syllables would soon be rushing into purged and attentive ears. The idea met obstruction at first. Why not wait till spring? London by now was shuddering under veils of December rain. But when they understood that all was decided, most of the objectors became allies. Warming to the scheme after initial demur, Mr. Prideau undertook to write to India, putting my démarche in a favourable light. I determined to announce the fait accompli by letter when I was safely on the way, perhaps from Cologne. Then we planned the dispatch of those weekly pounds, each time, if possible, after they had risen to a monthly total of 4, by registered letter to suitably spaced out poste restante. Munich would be the first, then I would write and suggest a second. I next borrowed £15 off the father of a school friend, partly to buy equipment and partly to have something in hand when I set out. I telephoned to my sister, Vanessa, back from India again a few years before, and married and settled in Gloucestershire. My mother was filled with apprehension to begin with. We pored over the atlas, and bit by bit, as we pored, the comic possibilities began to unfold in absurd imaginary scenes until we were falling about with laughter. And by the time I caught the train to London next morning, she was infected with my excitement. During the last days, my outfit assembled fast. Most of it came from Millett's Army Surplus Store in the Strand. An old army greatcoat, different layers of jersey, grey flannel shirts, a couple of white linen ones for best, a soft leather windbreaker, putties, nailed boots, a sleeping bag, to be lost within a month and neither missed nor replaced, notebooks and drawing blocks, rubbers and aluminium cylinder full of Venus and golden sovereign pencils, an old Oxford book of English verse, lost likewise, and to my surprise, it had been a sort of Bible, not missed much more than the sleeping bag. The other half of my very conventional travelling library was the Loeb Horace, Volume 1, which my mother, after asking what I wanted, had bought and posted in Guildford. She had written the translation of a short poem by Petronius on the flyleaf, chanced on and copied out, she told me later, from another volume on the same shelf. "Leave thy home, O youth, and seek out alien shores. Yield not to misfortune. The far-off Danube shall know thee. The cold north wind and the untroubled kingdom of Canopus and the men who gaze on the new birth of Phoebus or upon his setting." She was an enormous reader, but Petronius was not in her usual line of country, and he had only recently entered mine. I was impressed and touched. Finally, I bought a ticket on a small Dutch steamer sailing from Tower Bridge to the Hook of Holland. All this had taken a shark's bite out of my borrowed cash, but there was still a wad of notes left over. At last, with a touch of headache from an eve of departure party, I got out of bed on the great day, put on my new kit, and tramped southwest under a lowering sky. I felt preternaturally light, as though I were already away and floating like a gin escaped from its flask through the dazzling middle air while Europe unfolded. But the grating hobnails took me no farther than Clifton Place, where I picked up a rucksack left for me there by Mark Ogilvy Grant. Inspecting my stuff, he had glanced with pity at the one I had bought. His, a superior Bergen affair, resting on a lumbar semicircle of metal and supported by a triangular frame, had accompanied him, usually, he admitted, slung on a mule, all around Athos with Robert Byron and David Talbot Rice when The Station was being written. Weathered and faded by Macedonian suns, it was rife with manna. Then I bought for 9p a well-balanced ash plant at the tobacconist's next to the corner of Sloane Square and headed for Victoria Street and Petit France to pick up my new passport. Filling in the form the day before, born in London, 11th of February 1915, height 5'9" and 3/4, eyes brown, hair brown, distinguishing marks none, I had left the top space empty, not knowing what to write. Profession.
"Well, what shall we say?"
the passport official had asked, pointing to the void. My mind remained empty. A few years earlier, an American hobo song called "Hallelujah, I'm a Bum" had been on many lips. During the last days, it had been haunting me like a private leitmotif, and without realizing, I must have been humming the tune as I pondered, for the official laughed.
"You can't very well put that," he said.
After a moment, he added, "I should just write student." So I did. With a stiff new document in my pocket, stamped 8th of December 1933, I struck north, over the Green Park, under the dark massing of cloud. As I crossed Piccadilly and entered the crooked chasm of Whitehorse Street, there were a few random splashes, and glistening at the end of it, Shepherd Market was prickly with falling drops. I would be just in time for a goodbye luncheon with Miss Stewart and three friends, two fellow lodgers and a girl. Then away. The rain was settling in. The next move was my first independent act, and, as it turned out, with a run of luck, the first sensible one. You know the rest, dear Zan, disjointedly told, so here it is with an attempt at coherence. I hope that mentions of Crete remind you, as lucidly as me, of the ilex woods and the caves and the folds where our earlier adventures were first exchanged. Cardamyle, 1977. Chapter 1. The Low Countries.
"A splendid afternoon to set out," said one of the friends who was seeing me off, peering at the rain and rolling up the window. The other two agreed. Sheltering under the Curzon Street arch of Shepherd Market, we had found a taxi at last. In Half Moon Street, all collars were up. 1,000 glistening umbrellas were tilted over 1,000 bowler hats in Piccadilly. The German Street shops, distorted by streaming water, had become a submarine arcade. And the clubmen of Pall Mall, with China tea and anchovy toast in mind, were scuttling for sanctuary up the steps of their clubs. Blown askew, the Trafalgar Square fountains twirled like mops, and our taxi, delayed by a horde of Charing Cross commuters, reeling and stampeding under a cloudburst, crept into the Strand. The vehicle threaded its way through a flux of traffic. We splashed up Ludgate Hill, and the dome of St. Paul's sank deeper in its pillared shoulders. The tyres slewed away from the drowning cathedral, and a minute later the silhouette of the monument, descried through veils of rain, seemed so convincingly liquefied out of the perpendicular that the tilting thoroughfare might have been 40 fathoms down. The driver, as he swerved wetly into Upper Thames Street, leaned back and said, "Nice weather for young ducks." A smell of fish was there for a moment, then gone. Enjoining haste, the bells of St. Magnus the Martyr and St. Dunstan's in the East were tolling the hour. Then sheets of water were rising from our front wheels as the taxi floundered on between the Mint and the Tower of London. Dark complexes of battlements and treetops and turrets dimly assembled on one side. Then, straight ahead, the pinnacles and the metal parabolas of Tower Bridge were looming. We halted on the bridge just short of the first barbican, and the driver indicated the flight of stone steps that descended to Iron Gate Wharf. We were down them in a moment, and beyond the cobbles and the bollards, with a Dutch tricolour beating damply on her poop, and a ragged fan of smoke streaming over the river, the Stadhouder Willem rode at anchor. At the end of lengthening fathoms of chain, the swirling tide had lifted her, with a sigh, almost level with the flagstones. Gleaming in the rain, with full steam up for departure, she floated in a mewing circus of gulls. Haste and the weather cut short our farewells and our embraces, and I sped down the gangway, clutching my rucksack and my stick, while the others dashed back to the steps, 4 sodden trouser legs and 2 high heels skipping across the puddles, and up them to the waiting taxi. And half a minute later, there they were, high overhead on the balustrade of the bridge, craning and waving from the cast-iron quadrifoils. To shield her hair from the rain, the high heel wearer had a mackintosh over her head, like a coal heaver. I was signalling frantically back as the horses were cast loose and the gangplank shipped. Then they were gone. The anchor chain clattered through the port and the vessel turned into the current with a wail of her siren. How strange it seemed, as I took shelter in the little saloon, feeling suddenly forlorn, but only for a moment, to be setting off from the heart of London. No beetling cliffs, no Arnoldian crash of pebbles. I might have been leaving for Richmond, or for a supper of shrimps and whitebait at Gravesend instead of Byzantium. Only the larger ships from the Netherlands berthed at Harwich, the steward said. Smaller Dutch craft like the Stadhuder always dropped anchor hereabouts. Boats from the Zuider Zee had been unloading eels between London Bridge and the Tower since the reign of Queen Elizabeth. Miraculously, after the pitiless hours of deluge, the rain stopped. Above the drifts of smoke, there was a quickly fading glimpse of restless pigeons and a few domes and many steeples and some bone-white Palladian belfries flying rain-washed against a sky of gunmetal and silver and tarnished brass. The girders overhead framed the darkening shape of London Bridge. Further up, the teeming water was crossed by the ghosts of Southwark and Blackfriars. Meanwhile, St. Catherine's Wharf was sliding offstage and upstream, then Execution Dock and Wapping Old Stairs and the prospect of Whitby, and by the time these landmarks were astern of us, the sun was setting fast and the fissures among the western cloud banks were fading from smoky crimson to violet. In the gulfs, spanned by catwalks between the warehouses, night was assembling too, and the tiers of loading loopholes yawned like caverns. Slung with chains and cables weighted with shot, hoists jutted on hinges from precipices of warehouse wall, and the giant white letters of the wharfingers' names, grimed by a century of soot, were growing less decipherable each second. There was a reek of mud, seaweed, slime, salt smoke and clinkers and nameless jetsam and half-sunk barges and the waterlogged palisades unloosed a universal smell of rotting timber. Was there a whiff of spices? It was too late to say. The ship was drawing away from the shore and gathering speed, and the details beyond the wider stretch of water and the convolutions of the gulls were growing blurred. Rotherhithe, Millwall, Limehouse Reach, the West India docks, Deptford and the Isle of Dogs were rushing upstream in smears of darkness. Chimneys and cranes plumed the banks, but the belfries were thinning out. A chaplet of lights twinkled on a hill. It was Greenwich. The observatory hung in the dark, and the Stadhuder was twanging her way inaudibly through the Nort Meridian. The reflected shore lights dropped coils and zigzags into the flood, which were thrown into disarray every now and then by the silhouettes of passing vessels' luminous portholes, the funereal shapes of barges singled out by their port and starboard lights, and cutters of the river police smacking from wave to wave as purposefully and as fast as pikes. Once we gave way to a liner that towered out of the water like a festive block of flats. From Hong Kong, said the steward as she glided by, and the different notes of the sirens boomed up and downstream as though mastodons still haunted the Thames marshes. A gong tinkled, and the steward led me back into the saloon. I was the only passenger.
"We don't get many in December," he said. "It's very quiet just now."
When he had cleared away, I took a new and handsomely bound journal out of my rucksack, opened it on the green baize under a pink-shaded lamp, and wrote the first entry, while the cruets and the wine bottle rattled busily in their stands. Then I went on deck. The lights on either beam had become scarcer, but one could pick out the faraway gleam of other vessels, and estuary towns which the distance had shrunk to faint constellations. There was a scattering of buoys and the scanned flash of a lighthouse. Sealed away now beyond a score of watery loops, London had vanished, and a lurid haze was the only hint of its whereabouts. I wondered when I would be returning. Excitement ruled out the thought of sleep. It seemed too important a night, and in many ways so it proved. The 9th of December, 1933, was just ending, and I didn't get back until January 1937, a whole lifetime later, it seemed then, and I felt like Ulysses, plein d'usage et de raison, and, for better or for worse, utterly changed by my travels. But I must have dozed, in spite of these emotions, for when I woke, the only glimmer in sight was our own reflection on the waves. The kingdom had slid away westwards and into the dark. A stiff wind was tearing through the rigging, and the mainland of Europe was less than half the night away. It was still a couple of hours till dawn when we dropped anchor in the Hook of Holland. Snow covered everything, and the flakes blew in a slant across the cones of the lamps and confused the glowing discs that spaced out the untrodden quay. I hadn't known that Rotterdam was a few miles inland. I was still the only passenger in the train, and this solitary entry, under cover of night and hushed by snow, completed the illusion that I was slipping into Rotterdam and into Europe through a secret door. I wandered about the silent lanes in exultation. The beetling stories were nearly joining overhead. Then the eaves drew away from each other, and frozen canals threaded their way through a succession of humpbacked bridges. Snow was piling up on the shoulders of a statue of Erasmus. Trees and masts were dispersed in clumps, and the polygonal tiers of an enormous and elaborate Gothic belfry soared above the steep roofs. As I was gazing, it slowly tolled five. The lanes opened on the Pomgiers, a long quay lined with trees and capstans, and this, in its turn, gave on a wide arm of the mass and an infinity of dim ships. Gulls mewed and wheeled overhead and dipped into the lamplight, scattering their small footprints on the muffled cobblestones, and settled in the rigging of the anchored boats in little explosions of snow. The cafes and the seamen's taverns which lay back from the quay were all closed, except one which showed a promising line of light. A shutter went up, and a stout man in clogs opened a glass door, deposited a tabby on the snow, and, turning back, began lighting a stove inside. The cat went in again at once. I followed it, and the ensuing fried eggs and coffee ordered by signs were the best I had ever eaten. I made a second long entry in my journal. It was becoming in a passion, and while the landlord polished his glasses and cups and arranged them in glittering ranks, dawn broke, with the snow still coming down against the lightning sky. I put on my greatcoat, slung the rucksack, grasped my stick and headed for the door. The landlord asked where I was going. I said, "Constantinople." His brows went up, and he signalled to me to wait. Then he set out two small glasses and filled them with transparent liquid from a long stone bottle. We clinked them. He emptied his at one gulp, and I did the same. With his wishes for Godspeed in my ears, and an internal bonfire of bowls, and a hand smarting from his valedictory shake, I set off. It was the formal start of my journey. I hadn't gone far before the open door of the Grootkerk, the cathedral attached to the enormous belfry, beckoned me inside. Filled with dim early morning light, the concavity of grey masonry and whitewash joined in pointed arches high overhead, and the floor diminished along the nave in a chessboard of black and white flagstones. So compellingly did the vision tally with a score of half-forgotten Dutch pictures that my mind's eye instantaneously furnished the void with those 17th-century groups which should have been sitting or strolling there. Burghers with pointed, corn-coloured beards and impious spaniels that refused to stay outside, conferring gravely with their wives and their children, still as chessmen, in black broadcloth and identical honeycomb ruffs under the tremendous hatchmented pillars. Except for this church, the beautiful city was to be bombed to fragments a few years later. I would have lingered, had I known. In less than an hour, I was crunching steadily along the icy ruts of a dike road, and the outskirts of Rotterdam had already vanished in the falling snow. Lifted in the air and lined with willow trees, the road ran dead straight as far as the eye could see, but not so far as it would have in clear weather, for the escorting willows soon became ghost-like in either direction until they dissolved in the surrounding pallor. A wooden-clogged bicyclist would materialize, in a peaked cap with circular black ear pads against frostbite, and sometimes his cigar would leave a floating drift from Java or Sumatra on the air long after the smoker had evaporated. I was pleased by my equipment. The rucksack sat with an easy balance, and the upturned collar of my second-hand greatcoat, fastened with a semi-detachable flap, which I had just discovered, formed a snug tunnel. And with my old cord breeches, their strapping soft after long use, and the grey puttees and the heavy clouted boots, I was impenetrably greaved and jammed and shod. No chink was left for the blast. I was soon thatched with snow, and my ears began to tingle, but I was determined never to stoop to those terrible ear pads. When the snow stopped, the bright morning light laid bare a wonderful flat geometry of canals and polders and willows, and the sails of innumerable mills were turning in a wind that was also keeping all the clouds on the move, and not only clouds and mills, for soon the skaters on the canals, veiled hitherto by the snowfall, were suddenly scattered as a wind-borne portent came whirling out of the distance and tore through their midst like a winged dragon. It was an ice yacht, a raft on four rubber-tired wheels, under a taut triangle of sail and manned by three reckless boys. It travelled literally with the speed of the wind, while one of them hauled on the sail and another steered with a bar. The third flung all his weight on a brake, like a shark's jawbone that sent showers of fragments flying. It screamed past with an uproar of shouts as the teeth bit the ice and a noise like the rending of 100 calico shirts, which multiplied into 1,000 as the raft made a sharp right-angle turn into a branch canal. A minute later, it was a faraway speck, and the silent landscape, with its Bruegelish skaters circling as slowly as flies along the canals and the polders, seemed tamer after its passing. Snow had covered the landscape with a sparkling layer, and the slaty hue of the ice was only becoming visible as the looping arabesques of the skaters laid it bare. Following the white parallelograms, the lines of the willows dwindled as insubstantially as trails of vapour. The breeze that impelled those hastening clouds had met no hindrance for 1,000 miles, and a traveller, moving at a footpace along the hog's back of a dike, above the cloud shadows and the level champagne, was filled with intimations of limitless space. My spirits, already high, steadily rose as I walked. I could scarcely believe that I was really there. Alone, that is, on the move, advancing into Europe, surrounded by all this emptiness and change, with 1,000 wonders waiting. Because of this, perhaps, the actual doings of the next few days emerge from the general glow in a disjointed and haphazard way.
I halted at a signpost to eat a hunk of bread with a yellow wedge of cheese sliced from a red cannonball by a village grocer. One arm of the signpost pointed to Amsterdam and Utrecht, the other to Dordrecht, Breda, and Antwerp, and I obeyed the latter. The way followed a river with too swift a current for ice to form, and brambles and hazel and rushes grew thick along the banks. Leaning over a bridge, I watched a string of barges gliding downstream underneath me in the wake of a stertorous tug bound for Rotterdam, and a little later, an island, as slender as a weaver's shuttle, divided the current midstream. A floating, reed-fringed spinney, it looked like. A small castle, with a steeply pitched shingle roof and turrets with conical tops, emerged romantically from the mesh of the branches. Belfries of a dizzy height were scattered haphazard across the landscape. They were visible for a very long way, and in the late afternoon I singled one of them out for a landmark and a goal. It was dark when I was close enough to see that the tower and the town of Dordrecht, which gathered at its foot, lay on the other bank of a wide river. I had missed the bridge. But a ferry set me down on the other shore soon after dark. Under the jackdaws of the belfry, a busy amphibian town expanded. It was built of weathered brick and topped by joined gables and crow steps and snow-laden tiles and fragmented by canals and re-knit by bridges. A multitude of anchored barges loaded with timber formed a flimsy extension of the quays and rocked from end to end when bow waves from passing vessels stirred them. After supper, in a waterfront bar, I fell asleep among the beer mugs, and when I woke, I couldn't think where I was. Who were these bargees in peaked caps and jerseys and sea boots? They were playing a sort of whist in a haze of cheroot smoke, and the dog-eared cards they smacked down were adorned with goblets and swords and staves. The queens wore spiked crowns, and the kings and the knaves were slashed and ostrich-plumed, like Francois I and the Emperor Maximilian. My eyes must have closed again, for in the end someone woke me and led me upstairs like a sleepwalker, and showed me into a bedroom with a low and slanting ceiling and an eiderdown like a giant meringue. I was soon under it. I noticed an oleograph of Queen Wilhelmina at the bed's head and a print of the Synod of Dort at the foot before I blew the candle out. The clip-clop of clogs on the cobblestones, a puzzling sound until I looked out of the window, woke me in the morning. The kind old landlady of the place accepted payment for my dinner, but none for the room. They had seen I was tired and taken me under their wing. This was the first marvellous instance of kindness and hospitality that was to occur again and again on these travels. Except for the snow-covered landscape and the clouds and the tree-bordered flow of the Mureda, the next 2 days have left little behind them but the names of the towns I slept in. I must have made a late start from Dordrecht. Sliedrecht was the next halting place, is only a few miles on, and Hocken, the next after that, is not much more. Some old walls stick in my memory, cobbled streets and a barbican and barges moored along the river, but clearest of all, the town lock-up. Somebody had told me that humble travellers in Holland could doss down in police stations, and it was true. A constable showed me to a cell without a word, and I slept. Rugged up to the ears on a wooden plank hinged to the wall and secured on two chains under a forest of raffish murals and graffiti. They even gave me a bowl of coffee and a quarter of a loaf before I set off. Thank God I had put student in my passport. It was an amulet and an open sesame. In European tradition, the word suggested a youthful, needy, and earnest figure, spurred along the highways of the West by a thirst for learning, thus notwithstanding high spirits and the proneness to dog Latin drinking songs, a fit candidate for succour. During these first days, I was never far from a towpath, but so many and confused are the waterways that unconsciously I changed rivers 3 times. The Norweder was the first of them. The Merweder followed, then came the Val, and at Hocken the Val was joined by the Maas. In the morning I could see the great stream of the Maas winding across the plain towards this rendezvous. It had risen in France under the more famous name of Meuse, then flowed across the whole of Belgium, a river only less imposing than the Val itself, to whose banks I clung for the remainder of my Dutch journey. The Val is tremendous. No wonder, for it is really the Rhine. The Rhin in Holland, Rembrandt's native stream, is a minor northern branch of the main flow, and it subdivides again and again, loses itself in the delta, and finally enters the North Sea through a drainage canal. While the Val, gorged with alpine snows and the waters of Lake Constance and the Black Forest, and the tribute of 1,000 Rhenish streams, rolls seaward in usurped and stately magnificence. Between this tangle of rivers, meanwhile, whose defections and reunions enclosed islands as big as English shires, the geometric despotism of canal and polder and windmill held firm. Those turning sails were for drainage, not grinding corn. All the country I had traversed so far was below sea level, and without this discipline, which everlastingly redressed the balance between solid and liquid, the whole region would have been wild sea or a brackish waste of flood and fen. When one looked down from a dike, the infinity of polders and canals and the meanderings of the many streams were plain to the eye, but from a lower vantage point, only the nearest waters were discernible. But at ground level, they all vanished. I was sitting and smoking on a millstone by a barn near the old town of Zeltbommel when I was alerted by the wail of a siren. In the field a quarter of a mile away, between a church and some woods, serenely though invisibly afloat on the hidden mass, a big white ship, aflutter with pennants, was apparently mooing its way across solid meadows under a cloud of gulls. The mass advanced and retreated all day long, and towards evening it vanished to the south. Once out of sight, its wide bed climbed the invisible gradients of Brabant and Limburg, bound for a faraway Carolingian hinterland beyond the Ardennes. Dark fell while I was trudging along a never-ending path beside the Val. It was lined with skeleton trees. The frozen ice puddles creaked under my hobnails, and beyond the branches, the Great Bear and a retinue of winter constellations blazed in a clear, cold sky. At last, the distant lights of Tiel, poised on the first hill I had seen in Holland, twinkled into being on the other bank. An opportune bridge carried me over, and I reached the marketplace soon after 10, somnambulant with fatigue after traversing a vast stretch of country. I can't remember under what mountainous eiderdown or in what dank cell I slept the night. A change came over the country. For the first time next day, the ground was higher than sea level, and with every step, the equipoise of the elements tilted more decisively in favour of dry land. A gentle, rolling landscape of water meadow and ploughland and heath, with the snow melting here and there, stretched away northward through the province of Hildeland and south into Brabant. The roadside cavalries and the twinkle of sanctuary lamps in the churches indicated that I had crossed a religious as well as a cartographic contour line. There were farm buildings which elms and chestnut trees and birches snugly encompassed, and hobena-like avenues of wintry trees which ended at the gates of seemly manor houses, the abodes, I hoped, of mild Jonkers. They were gabled in semicircles, and broken right angles of weathered brick bordered with white stone. Pigeon lofts saddled the scales of the roofs, and the breeze kept the gilded weather vanes spinning. And when the leaded windows kindled at lighting up time, I explored the interiors in my imagination. A deft chiaroscuro illuminated the black and white flagstones. There were massive tables with bulbous legs and turkey carpets flung over them, Convex mirrors distorted the reflections. Faded wall charts hung on the walls. Globes and harpsichords and inlaid lutes were elegantly scattered. And Helderland squires with pale whiskers, or their wives, in tight bonnets and goffered ruffs, lifted needle-thin wine glasses to judge the colour by the light of the branching and globular brass candelabra, which were secured on chains to the beams and the coffered ceilings. Imaginary interiors. No wonder they took shape in painting terms. Ever since those first hours in Rotterdam, a three-dimensional Holland had been springing up all around me and expanding into the distance in conformity with another Holland, which was already in existence and in every detail complete. For if there is a foreign landscape familiar to English eyes by proxy, it is this one. By the time they see the original, 100 mornings and afternoons in museums and picture galleries and country houses have done their work. These confrontations and recognition scenes filled the journey with excitement and delight. The nature of the landscape itself, the colour, the light, the sky, the openness, the expanse, and the details of the towns and the villages are leagued together in the weaving of a miraculously consoling and healing spell. Melancholy is exorcised, chaos chased away, and a well-being, alacrity of spirit, and a thoughtful calm take their place. In my case, the relationship between familiar landscape and reality led to a further train of thought. A second kind of scenery, the Italian, is almost as well known in England as the Dutch, and for the same gallery-haunting reasons. How familiar, at one remove, are those piazzas and arcades? The towers and the ribbed cupolas give way to the bridged loops of a river, and the rivers coil into umbered distances between castled hills and walled cities. There are shepherds' hovels and caverns. The fleece of woods succeeds them, and the panorama dies away in fluted mountains that are dim or gleaming under skies with no more clouds than a decorative wreath of white vapour. But this scenery is a backcloth merely for lily-bearing angels who flutter to earth or play violins and lutes at nativities. Martyrdoms are enacted in front of it. Miracles take place, and mystic marriages, scenes of torture, crucifixions, funerals, and resurrections. Processions wend rival armies close in a deadlock of striped lances, or an ascetic greybeard strikes his breast with a stone, or writes at a lectern while a lion slumbers at his feet. A sainted stripling is riddled with crossbow bolts, and gloved prelates collapse with upcast eyes and swords embedded across their tonsures. Now, all these transactions strike the eye with a monopolizing impact. For 5 centuries and more, in many thousands of frames, they have been stealing the scene. And when the strange deeds are absent, recognition is much slower than it is in the Low Countries, where the precedence is reversed. In Holland, the landscape is the protagonist, and merely human events, even one so extraordinary as Icarus, falling headfirst in the sea because the wax in his artificial wings has melted, are secondary details. Next to Bruegel's ploughed field and trees and sailing ship and ploughman, the falling aeronaut is insignificant. So compelling is the identity of picture and reality that all along my path, numberless dawdling afternoons in museums were being summoned back to life and set in motion. Every pace confirmed them. Each scene conjured up its echo. The masts and quays and gables of a river port, the backyard with a besom leaning against a brick wall, the checkerboard floors of churches. There they all were, the entire range of Dutch themes ending in taverns, where I expected to find boars carousing and found them. And in every case, like magic, the painter's name would simultaneously impinge. The willows, the roofs, the bell towers, the cows grazing self-consciously in the foreground meadows. There was no need to ask whose easels they were waiting for as they munched. These vague broodings brought me, somewhere between Teal and Nijmegen, it must have been, to the foot of one of those vertiginous belfries which are so transparent in the distance and so solid close to. I was inside it and up half a dozen ladders in a minute and gazing down through the cobwebbed louvres. The whole kingdom was revealed. The two great rivers loitered across it with their scatterings of ships and their barge processions and their tributaries. There were the polders and the dikes and the long willowed bordered canals, the heath and arable and pasture dotted with stationary and expectant cattle, windmills and farms and answering belfries, bare rookeries with their wheeling specks just within earshot, and a castle or two, half concealed among a ruffle of woods. The snow had melted here, or fallen more lightly. Blue and green and pewter and rusted and silver composed the enormous vista of turf and flood and sky. There was a low line of hills to the east, and everywhere the shine of intruding water, and even a faint glimmer far away to the north of the Zuyder Zee. Filled with strange light, the peaceful and harmonious land slid away to infinity under a rush of clouds. In the bottom chamber, as I left, an octet of clogged bell-ringers was assembling and spitting on their palms before grasping the sallies, and the clangor of their scales and changes, muted to a soft melancholy by the distance, followed me for the next few miles of nightfall and sharpening chill. It was dark, long before I reached the quays of Nijmegen. Then, for the first time for days, I found myself walking up a slant and down again. Lanes of steps climbed from the crowding ships along the waterfront. Between the lamplight and the dark, tall towers and zigzag facades impended. The quayside lamps strung themselves into the distance beside the dark flow of the Vaal, and upstream, a great iron bridge sailed northwards and away for miles beyond the river. I had supper, and after filling in my journal, I searched the waterfront for a sailor's doss house, and ended up in a room over a blacksmith's. I knew it was my last night in Holland, and I was astonished how quickly I had crossed it. My heels might have been winged. I was astonished, too, at the impressive clear...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.